Hello, I'll show you a few things we're using today. I tend to like a certain set of brushes. Black Gold by Dynasty. They're a fantastic brush. That's a number 4, 2. This one's a 10. This is a Bob Ross liner brush. I use it for everything. Anything with a small line. Watercolor brush for spreading is really good. I like to use heavy body acrylics. Almost all of them that you'll see. Either Liquitex, Golden. Those are my favorites. Cad Red Light. Hansa Yellow. This is more of a transparent yellow. Ultramarine Blue. Dioxygene Purple. I use this on almost all my paintings, a lot of my drip paintings, and just regular illustrations. These are all heavy bodied. It gives you so much more ability to make the paint lighter. Even with a transparent color, you can get a lot better results by spending a little bit more for better paint. Not saying you can't do this with student paints, but you can do it better with heavy body acrylics. What I have here is two pieces of identical paper, one black, one white, to show you value differences. This is all mixed media paper, which you can use for acrylics. It'll come in, you know, white, sometimes gray, brown, black. This is Strathmore black, wonderful for airbrush or for acrylic work. You want a black canvas, and that's why I'm doing this video today, to show you how using a different canvas, if you're using canvas, you would paint it with a black gesso, let it dry, and then you'd be set to go. And everything, all your values would do have the black behind them. You can also use gray. If you're doing oil paints, you would mix it with a Van Dyke brown or some sort of a brown or a gray. Mix it with linseed oil, or a medium is your favorite choice. Speaking of mediums, another trick for your acrylic work to let it not dry as fast is to use airbrush extender, transparent extender. It makes your paints last longer, your using time with them is more, and just all around makes things better. There's other tricks too, but like I said, acrylics dry so fast that the artistic ability is limited because you have to rush so much. Sometimes you just dip your paintbrush in water and you hope for the best, but give an airbrush extender a try. You'd probably be quite amazed what you can do with it. I'll put up some pictures of my palette and discuss that at a later time. Okay, I've got this paper really close here. I was considering doing one landscape, but I think just to cause this area not to bleed over, I'm going to use a little bit of painter's tape. This is the special, does not tear your paper apart. You know, I'm not sure who makes this. This is a 3M product, just Scotch Blue painter's tape. I don't get a lot of tears with it, but I find it works really, really well for what we're doing. Again, we're on a piece of glass here, and I have a piece of paper behind it. You can't really see in the camera, but I like working with glasses. I take a razor blade and I'll clean off any extra paint off of it, and I'll show you some pictures of that. Also in this video, you're cleaning your workspace, the better. So the first thing we're going to do, now that we have this line here between our two paintings, is we figure out where our horizon line is. And what you want to do is never I mean, you can, but if you put your horizon line in the very center, it's displeasing to the eye. You know, the rule of thirds, you can look up, you'll see what I'm talking about. If that was our horizon up here and that's the sky, then that's all that water we have to deal with. Of course, you could have a beach down here or whatever you're painting. This could also be horizontal. I didn't do it horizontal today because I have limited space. But in this case, I'm more concerned with the sky. The stuff I'll show you on water is pretty simple. But the very first thing to do is say, okay, we'll go ahead and put our horizon line right about there. And I just use a piece of tape to create that. The reason you want the tape is because the human eye is always looking for those straight lines which don't exist in nature. There is always a natural curvature to the earth. But in this case, we need to have a horizon line, and that's exactly what that's going to give us. Below here will be water and two different looks. Here will be sky and two different looks. Here, because it's black, you have the option of doing stars. You can do clouds in either one. You can do we can do some mountain elements. You know, you can do small details like boats or whatever. But we'll get into that, and I'll show you what you can do with a little bit of planning on the next part. Just give you an idea of my palette. I'm using a water-based palette. It has a sponge underneath the palette, and I line the edges with some paper towels, damp paper towels, and separate my colors out. This is regular titanium white, which I generally don't use. I usually use a white gesso. This iridescent white over here, because I have some neat things that you can do with iridescent colors. Two yellows, one opaque and one transparent, right here, opaque and transparent. This is your blue and your purple. The names are strange. Fatal Cyclene Blue and Dioxamine Purple. These two are great for horizons and for landscape. You have your Cad Red. I have my orange. It's actually a yellow ochre, but it's a very dark orange. Phthalo Blue, Cerulean Blue. I like to play with different blue colors with skies. I wish I had two cameras so you could see this at the same time, but basically what you're doing is using this area to mix your colors. So you just grab a thumb. This keeps, with your paints over here, it keeps the center from getting all discombobulated. Spray this down with water. Spray gun as you're going. It'll keep the paints all perfect for you. And you can put the lid on it and it will last for weeks. A little bit of water. I often like to put some water on where I'm working. Even though you can't see it, you can get an idea. Got as much light as I got going in here. A little bit of your transparent medium. I put that right in the center of my palette. Get some going in the brush. I'll take some pictures of this stuff. And again, transparent colors don't show up on black hardly at all. You need a little something opaque to make that happen. White, not a problem. So if you know that your darkest color is going to be up here, you can go right into your darkest blue, a little bit of purple if you want, and just start working that. Get a little bit of transparent medium in there, and you can see what happens when you thin that a little bit. It starts to work its way down. And I'm going to add a bit of water at this point. This paper can take it. And so I'm just going to mess with the sky here and say, let's go ahead and just do some colors and get it in there. Tempted to do a drip painting at this point. I'm going to add a bit of white in here because that is opaque. And you can see what happens when you put white into the blue. It immediately, you can't see the background. So we'll start working with that. And I'm just trying to say how much, when acrylics dry, they always dry darker. So I'm just going to rely on water now because I pretty much got stuff the way I want it. Again, I'm working on a drafting board, so there's an angle to it. So keep a rag nearby. And your goal here, I would normally use a bigger brush. Your goal here is just to create kind of a water effect at the base here. And just kind of smooth it on out. As we move across here, if I was to put some paint here, it'll work. But see, you don't see much of it because you have a black background. And I'll show you how to deal with that in a minute. All paintings have brush strokes. As they start to dry, they will leave. But that's what gives your painting its authenticity. You know, if you want to use Photoshop to create paintings, you won't have these lines, but that's the price you pay. All right, so we've got some sky going on there. You know, you could easily just go in here, clean your brush a little bit, and go straight into your some white. And I'm using a pretty big brush here, but you could do, start doing some cloud effects, you know, get them in there. There's really not a lot you can screw up. Wipe your brush every time you go into your paint and just start working. Yeah, I want some clouds there. Okay, whatever. Basic cloud stuff. If I was to do this right over here, you would see it immediately because it's an opaque paint on black. I'm just going to work with that. Take a dry brush, you know, do some circles. Again, all we're doing here is just lifting so that our sky is just a little more animated. And we'll come back to that later. We may darken the top up some more too. On the dark side, we gotta clean your brushes first. You know, the dark side, your light's gonna be at the horizon. Let's say our sunset is down there or whatever. If you go with a transparent yellow, you can't see it. If I go with an opaque, you'll immediately see it. So, you know, if you have a sunburst, sunset going on over here, we're just going to do some yellow. Going to get our color in there, and it's transparent, as you can see. Add a little more water in there, and we start getting, oh, that's kind of cool, you know. And light, of course, is moving around, so. If I had just a touch of white, I can lighten that all up. Go into your water, just lift it. And we have to decide at this point, you know, how much do we want here? I don't want too much, but you can kind of get the idea. Start doing some sort of an idea. We'll add more white and light at the bottom. I want a touch of yellow. Oh, yeah, I'm going to do a bit of orange. Make it kind of come alive a little bit. Because you're dealing with black, everything you do is very, very intense. So that's got some cool things going. Again, you see how the lines you can do with these brushes, these dynasty brushes? That's pretty cool. That's the purple color, and what I'm doing is I'm getting it on here pretty thick. And a bit of the blue and purple together. The reason is because I'm gonna infuse that with some white in a minute. I need some of the extender on there so it doesn't dry as fast. Get some of that going on. That's our darkest point there. And this is going to be our lightest point here. Well, I've got that pretty wet. So, if this is a night sky over the ocean, obviously I have a light source. It's going to come up from the middle. It's going to get my colors going. Start blending. X's. I'm going to bring that purple-blue mixture right down into my white. Bring that white right down into the center. A little bit of orange. Okay, that's how my light's going to go. Use your extender so it doesn't dry on you. As it will, the paper absorbs. And there we go. Starting to see the color transition, the gradient. Up into the dark. I'll go red into my purple again. Add a bit of extender. And bring that dark carefully down so my gradient transition is working for me. Alright. And let that dry, and then we'll come back and go from there. Alright, I've covered this side so I don't get any white marks over here. What I'm going to do is Use a small, very stiff brush. Go into some water. Go into my white. Get it nice and wet. You can see that's really loaded with paint. I'm just going to wipe it off. And then add some stars. Got some more paint. Wipe it off. And you can fleck this as much as you want. Depends on how much stars you actually want. If you're not careful and add too much water. So I've got a nice star field over there. You guys can get an idea what that looks like. If you want a few bigger drops, which looks really cool. Let's get a little closer. And that'll be that. You can take off the other side and continue on with that. Adding some transparent yellow now that I've got some opaque going on down there. Yeah, I use my fingers a lot. You'll see some bubbles in the paper, but that can be taken out later on. Just wet the back. Put something heavy on it. Just creating a horizon line. A little bit of the orange, a little bit of the white. Kind of quickly putting that in there. If you get paint chunks or colors you don't like, just lift them off. But I leave this part kind of striated. I like how it looks. Keep your brush with you. You can do the same thing on the other side. You can use some transparent yellow. Wet brush. Start adding some color. Sunset colors. A little bit of orange. Orange is also transparent, so you're going to see the blues behind it. Keep it loose, keep it wet. Let the blue show behind it. You can be bold and go into some reds if you want. Really add some color. Splash of color in your sunset. Just work that up. Clean out the brush really well and dry brush. It's actually a wet brush, watercolor type stuff. If you get pigments, got some clouds up here. What's often cool here is just to, oops, too much paint. It's just to highlight the bottoms of your clouds with white and yellow, orange. Bit much. Clean the brush. At this point you can do a couple things. What I like to do is take that same old scrubby brush and actually do that. Just scrub the bottoms of it. Scrub your paint right in. Small circles. Accenting. And this is all background stuff. Not that important right now. I'm gonna bring some white and yellow. Okay, I'm back. I wouldn't suggest doing what I'm doing is two paintings at once, but you know, if you're playing with values, what we're showing is that the difference is in a black canvas versus a white. You know, the acrylic, so you can dry your stuff real quick. Use a dry brush on the remaining paint. And we've got kind of a neat sky situation going on. Grab some purple. Maybe work in the top here a little bit with the brush. Transparent medium. Purple and blue. Darken up those corners. So we're transitioning from sun sundown up until our sky. I normally wouldn't put clouds until last, but you can't really make a mistake. If you don't like them, paint over them. Wet the brush, dry it off, back and forth. Don't be afraid to go over what you already painted. If I can reinforce it afterward. Alright, starting to like that. I may put some stars up there, I haven't decided yet. I'm going to wet the brush, because the purple is transparent. It's going to bring it down. What I'm trying to do here, I wasn't supposed to do that. If you get something down on the light, wet it, blend it in. You can also use a spray on here. I use a spray bottle, I'll show it to you in a minute. And I still have my accent cloud showing through, which is what I wanted. And I'm going to preserve the light down here and leave the blue up there. And I'm going to put those clouds back in a minute. All right, like where that's going. On the night side, you can do clouds. You're just going to do impressions of them. A fan brush is great for that. You can also just use the small scrub brush that I was telling you about. It's number two. You know, you can go into your blue and your white. Blue, remember, when you add the white, you're going to be hitting opaque. So, it doesn't hurt to always dry your brush off first and start working a little bit if you want it darker. Here I'm using some purple. And I'm just going to do the impressions of clouds there. The white that I have and the purple together are great. And all I'm going to do here is just do the impressions of them. No hard lines. I may want to add a little bit of orange on there. If something's going on. Wet brush. The minute you add water, it'll give you a lot more control. This is a good place to demonstrate the liner brush. Wet it. You can go into an accent color. You can do a yellow or a white. You know, you can start really bringing in a few accents. We could do a moon up here the same way. All I'm doing here is just doing some accents. I'm just wiggling the brush. All I'm doing. Grab a bit more. I'm saying, hey, something's going on up here. Wet the brush, clean it out, fade it out. You really can't make a mistake. All we're doing is saying there's some stuff back there going on. Purple, yellow, and blue. And on the very bottom, we can add a little fire. We'll do some red, some oranges. Careful with that red. I'm using the brush sideways. That's how I tend to use it when I'm doing stuff, landscape stuff. I get a lot more control over it. And then finally, it could just be a touch bit of white as the final. As the light is coming up from here, I'm just going to accent that a little bit. You could actually descend this down if you want. I mean, it's unlimited what you can do. Just work in layers. All right, we're going to leave that just for now, because then we have everything that we want. If this is too kind of crazy for you down here, don't worry. We're going to fix that. And we're doing a water underneath this, so you can take a tiny bit of water and just, because you have extender, it's still alive, it's still movable. The secret is to really clean out your brush and then just really dry it, or grab a fresh brush. I'm just going to bring the light up to meet the dark. And don't be afraid to do this motion, the scrub motion, and do X's also. Anything that you need so your transition is smooth. Okay, I'm liking how that goes. In a moment, we're going to take this tape off and we're going to move on down. But I think before we do that, we're going to do some mountains in the back here. All right, there's two of my favorite colors by Golden. These are open acrylics. It means they're slow drying. So keep that in mind when using the extender. One is called Payne's Gray and the other is called Bone Black. I don't normally use black or white, but in this case, I'm using something like it. These are both transparent blacks, and I can't tell you how valuable they are with painting. Payne's Gray has kind of a bluish, smoky, clear, transparent look that you can use for shadows. Just what's wonderful. Bone Black is the same thing. It's more of a, it's like charcoal on your hands. It's like painting with charcoal is the best way I can describe it. What I'm using now is a little bit of Bone Black because the Payne's Gray is more for shadows. And so I'm just going to go in with a number 4 brush and create the shapes. I'm going straight into the paint here. And when you're doing mountains or any kind of a cliff or whatever, just, you know, you're, oh, here we are. We're somewhere in Hawaii, and we're just going to put this over, and it's transparent, as you can see. It gives us the ability to see what things are going to look like. Let's say there's a mountain here. If you wad this down a little bit, you can do a fine line up, create a spire if you want. Try to get out of the way so you can see. I'm going to go into a little bit of purple here, which will darken it. And we're just going to do the face of a cliff coming down into the water. And the same thing on the other side. You can add blue or purple. We want this dark here because we're going to be adding accent colors to it. But as you can see, the Payne's Gray, I mean the Bone Black in the front creates a shadow that I'll try to zoom in for you. Combining purple and blue, I'm just going to block this in. And I'm just going to leave it because it's going to be going down into our water. And leave it just like that. Nothing fancy. Same thing over here. Let's just go, just create a mountain. You can probably see. Because I'm already on a black background, it's going to be much easier to fill this in. And it's going to look like a black blob right now, and that's fine, because we're going to put on our accent colors afterward. All the accents are going to be coming from this area down here. Same thing over here. We could actually get kind of fancy, do a couple spires. If you look at a lot of my paintings, you'll see work like this, and this is how it's done. You could also do a ledge with palm trees on it, but in this case, it's going to be more of a, I don't know. Let your imagination go. I'm adding a little bit of blue in there, or the lighter blue. And I'm going to fill in the corner. Add another spire. Go down a little bit further, add another spire. So it looks like mountains in the background, real high. Kind of a third world thing, you know? Just let your imagination go. Simple brush strokes up. Because we're going to block in all the color here at the end, you'll see. Okay, so we have a nice little, weird little world going on here behind our sky. Just going to add a few more little touches in there, and I'm going to let that dry up. As you see, I'm already pulling the light in from the paint before. That's how slow the acrylics are drying, and you know why now, because we're using extender, which is wonderful. Right, we're going to be careful over here because we don't want to really mess with the light right now. I've got this really blue over here, so I'm going to add some more of the Bone Black in the corner so I have a nice dark on the opposite side where the light is. I'm going to fix my spire and add another one there. Up brush strokes. This could be trees, could be mountains, could be whatever you want it to be. And there's our sunset in here. All right. Darken this up in the corner here. Again, we're dealing with values here. Because this is a white background, the darks are really going to show up. Over here, it's a dark background, so that any light we put in is going to show up. That's the difference in your values in using a black canvas versus a white. All right. Let that dry and we'll come back and let some magic happen. Alright, gonna pull off our horizon line. So now we've got a fresh line to work with. And here we'll have our water on either side. The minute we put blue or white over here, you're going to see waves, reflections, you're going to see everything right away because it's dark. We have to do a blue base on this side just to get the value from this white. And again, if your horizon line was up here, you could have water down here and then have a break line here and have this part be underwater. You could have whales and sharks or whatever you wanted down in this area. Or you could just have the water come to a beach down here. You could have palm trees coming up. Do the same thing on this side too. That's really what you want to accomplish. So as soon as this area dries a little bit more, I'm going to retape off the top here for a little while so that I don't get any contamination in my paint below. I want to preserve this line because this is where the eye is going to be drawn. Here on the dark side, the lightest part, and over here in the center. Again, I don't normally make mountains this symmetrical, but this is just to show you what's possible. And then you can play with the ideas. You may not even want mountains in your picture. You may just want some clouds or whatever and call it done. Changed my mind on retaping the top. I don't think we need to. But what we need to do is establish our values. As you can see, I have quite a lot of paint on there for the acrylic. So I'm going to add a little bit more extender. And I got purple instead of blue. No problem. A lot of times with marine colors, I'd love to add a little bit of green, so I'll add a touch of yellow in there to give them some green. And again, all I'm doing is creating a color that I can use. Be real careful at horizon line. This is where it's important. To create a nice dark color for your water to show. Really good brush like this, you can create your horizon. You can just go up to that line, get it as straight as you can. Paint from the shoulder, not the wrist or the hand. Keep them just as stiff as a board. Move your way along until, oops, that's going to become a wave. All right. Get some base color in there. We're moving horizontally. The eye will catch the vertical strokes. And we're just going to bring our color. Again, this is a nice purple-blue color, which is perfect for water, especially on a white. Going to block in some color. In my corners, I'm going to go right into my bone black. So I want the darker colors. Perfect. In the front. Alright. I'm going to move everything horizontal. I'm just going to quickly brush that in. So I've got a nice solid over here. It's a different story, because right at this horizon line, the only thing we're going to need is our blues, because the black will take care of the rest. And I'm putting in just a touch of the iridescent white that we talked about. I'm going to go in the thinner and the extender. I'm just going to start working this beautiful color as lighter toward the horizon line. I went over it. I should have taped it off, but you guys get the point. Alright. Because it's a transparent color, the blue, the black underneath does an absolutely gorgeous job of letting you see the black inside of the blue, down below the blue. Now on the sides, I'm going to do the same thing. I'm going to grab a bit more of the bone black. The reason I'm going so dark is because you have to have the dark to show light. That's where your values come in. I'm going to put my bone black right in my corners again, because it's a transparent black. Add some water to my brush and just blend it all in. A little bit of bone black in the corners, keeping that line nice and clean. Same thing over here. That's what the tape is for. The center tape, anyway. Okay. I'm going to block that in. I'll go across it a couple times. You'll see a little bit of white splatter here. A dark blue on the horizon. Don't worry about that. We'll hit that with some lighter color and cover it right up. Just want to make sure that my colors are really clean all the way across. Again, I can drag and pull. More water. This paint is going to stay good for probably an hour, maybe longer. So I'm just going to take that opportunity to really smooth out these lines. And don't be afraid to add some yellow, even on the dark side. As you know, oceans are green, it's blue, they change all the time. By getting the base color, I'm going to have to add some orange. Getting ahead of myself, but you see what I'm doing. I'm going to add a little bit of orange here, just to indicate that there's a light source coming here. I'm going to start to work with it. The paint is still wet, so I'm able to do that. The minute I touch it with a bit of white, you can see what happens. Dry the brush. And I'm using a pretty big brush here, but I'm doing it purposely. Just to get some basic color up near that horizon. This is how I paint normally anyway. I don't wait for stuff to dry fully. There's advantages to both. Again, you're moving in commas. I normally would do this with a fan brush. Start doing wave patterns. And you can just go. In this case, I'm going from one to the other because they're right beside each other. And water doesn't really follow any rules, honestly. You just need to blend it. Dry your brush off on a rag. This is what I'm doing back here, by the way. Just brushing it off. And you're going to blend up into the bottom of the waves. Blend that dark up. Got to preserve the dark underneath it. That's why you don't want too much white right now. Right now we are just concerned with some basic shapes. Blend up from the bottom up so that your wave is starting to take some shape. But you're not losing your darks. Alright, we're going to stop there, I think. And we'll come back and put in some mountains. The highlights on the mountains. And then bring that highlight down into our water. And we'll go from there. Okay. This is a Dynasty Black Silver, number 4. It has a nice chiseled edge on the end, as you can see. And it's perfect. We're going to go into some orange. Transparent orange, a little bit of red. And I'm going to add just a purple, a little bit of purple on that. And it's going to be loaded up pretty good. And just, once you get it loaded up, wipe it off. Go into your mountains, and this is where you start picking out your different shapes. All you're doing, because the brush is flat on the end, it's just allowing that to work for you. You can add a tiny bit of white, but make sure you wipe it off, because you can see what happens. It becomes alive immediately. Just accent the side of the cliff with your upstrokes. And you want to move in kind of square motions. Don't be afraid to put some of that purple back in there if you want. I'm just going back into all the colors on my palette. I'm just picking out different areas where the light is on the mountains. And I'm creating a tiny bit of blue still drying over there, so I'm going to block the bottoms of these. Back into my orange. Because way up in the mountain it's further away from the light source, so I don't want to do too much. But red is wonderful over here. When you get a fiery color, bring it down to the face of your mountains. And this is still a little wet over here, but all I'm doing is accenting this side of the cliff, making it come alive. You can drop into some white a little bit if you're careful. All I'm saying is that there's some nice rock shapes over here, and I'm letting the paint pick them up. When you get closer to the front here, you can use the edge of your brush and really accent that front of them just a little bit more. Dry your brush off if you get too much going on. Redefine the shapes. Again, it's moving, flowing down, up, up, up. And we may let our rock shape just tweed a little face over here. If you get too many strong lines, just move it back. And all you're doing is creating a surface. You're defining those rock shapes out of the solid black. As you can see, as it picks up, you want to preserve the dark in the back. Adding some red in there, right on top. And, you know, dry your brush, you can actually indicate that's not dry enough. So, have any problems putting your fingers in there? Alright, if you want to smooth it a little bit, wash your brush out and just do some wiggling. Literally, that's all you're doing. You're just smoothing out, creating a transition point like that. Alright, that's enough for that side. Same thing on the other side. Now the value differences we were talking about, when you start to pull out these colors, you need very little actual color coming out. It's almost the way you paint with oils, it just doesn't dry, oils don't dry as fast. Alright, we'll let that set and then we'll hit it from there. Alright, okay, as you can see, I've got this side accented. My big head was in the way, so I couldn't show you a lot of this, but I've got some interesting striations with different colors going on here that I'm just going to leave right now. So I kind of like the kind of rough look. So you could let this just be water, or you could put a beach over here. You could do a tree element, like a palm tree if you wanted to, but to kind of show you how to create depth, which is to push everything back, is up here we want the same colors that we have up in our sky, a little bit of transparent yellow and a little bit of orange, once we put those colors down here, again, wet the brush, wipe it off, using the tape to our advantage, we can create a shoreline. And it's got some white in there too. All we're doing is reflecting the colors that we see already. So we're just going to bring those colors down, and a little bit of red if we want. And again, we don't want the hard lines. We want it to fade, so I don't mind going back into the blue a little bit. And just let that wash over, wipe it off. Now I'm just going to create like a shoreline reflection. Wash the brush off. I'm just going to let that be a reflection of the sky up there. I mean, you've got all kinds of stars and all that. You don't need all that. You just need a little bit of light down there. And we'll leave this one. Actually, with this one, since our light source is here, we need to brighten it up a little bit. We're just going to go into our colors, orange, white, and just lighten up the very center. I'm using a very big brush here, and I'm wiping it off continually, that's too much paint. And we're going to bring, same thing we did in the sky, going light to dark and bringing the dark down. We're going to wet the brush, grab our colors and pull them. I'm just going to bring that center part down. Grab a little blue, bit of blue and bring it down, and then work it back up so that we're creating some depth. As you can see, I'm painting right over the waves I did earlier, but it's my painting, so I can do that. There we go. Over here, there'll be some accent of lights, and in these corners are going to be dark, but right here in the center, it's going to be our lightest point. So just keep working it. Forward. Same thing here. Grab some white, touch of yellow. Using a big brush. It's fading out on the corners. I don't want to cover up my blues. I'm just going to create my waves coming forward, creating depth of field. And that's probably enough. A little more white right here. I'm not thinning this at all, I'm just putting it straight on. Accenting that horizon line. A lot going on up there, that horizon line. Way off in the distance. I'm gonna bring that forward. Moving in commas, ups and downs. This is our lightest point, it's right in the center. Okay. Now you can have some fun. Now that you've got some depth going on, grab a fan brush. Very useful. You don't have to use a fan brush, it's just helpful. I like to wet my brush first, wipe it off, and go straight into my white. One of the rare times you actually do. And the whole idea here is to get it thin, mix it with some airbrush transparent extender, or water if you have it, get it loaded, wipe it off, and you're just going to do little shapes, little wave shapes. You can pick where you want a bigger wave if you want. There's another one right here. Get some basic shapes going. Over here, what you can do, because you have a beach, if you will, you can actually create, actually I'm going to do that differently, do the same thing up here. start creating some shapes, wave shapes. And this brush is pretty old. It's giving me a lot of trouble. It's not really doing the fan things that I want it to do. I'm going to move off of that. Not too happy with how that's turning out. But I can pick up my liner brush, which is what I like to work with. Go into my white. And we have, you know, I hold it sideways. Turn it. Spin it as you go. Alright, we have some basic shapes going of our shoreline. I'm going to accent it from behind. As this beach is rolling up. And what you can do what I like to do anyway. Then the brush. And start pulling out some lighter waves. You're going to have a lot of frothy stuff going on. And then you want to pull it back. Get into your blues. Start blending those colors back. Wet brush. It's very, very wet. I'm working with water here, basically. And I'm pulling the color that's already there. I'm creating my own types of waves. I'm going in the bottom of my waves. I'm just going to scrub, blend in the bottoms. It's a very dry brush. Tap, tap, to create your little water movement. You can twist the brush. This is why a fan brush is so wonderful. Automatic wave creator. Or cloud creator. Pull it back. Once you start seeing some shape that you're really enjoying, dry the brush, clean it out more. Go back into your blue, your transparent blue. See what I'm doing? I'm accenting the edges of the water. Creating my depth in the center, fading in the bottoms.
The transparent blue goes right over the white and gives you a really, really nice effect. Plus you're tying in all the colors. Pull up on the brush. Comma shapes. Leave the take your little liner brush. Some white accents in there. One there. Turning it and twisting it. Almost a watercolor going on. Things back there you're not going to see as well. But here you would. Don't feel... go into your painting's gray if you want a little bit. Have some fun with that. Again, it's your shadow color. You can create some elements in the water. Waves have a shadow. I like to put an edge when I have a beach line, a shadow, if you will, right underneath the very front edge. You may have to use a little bit of blue on that, blue and black paint gray. Find that line. Stand out a little bit. Pull it back. Wash it out. Have your fan brush again. And just put back in your line. Very light touch back here. Little accent. What you're doing is just looking for places that need a little more action. And just adding a tiny bit of white right over them. tilt the brush as you go. Come up with some interesting stuff. I'm just showing you options on what you can do. Just keep working on it. You know, decide where you want to wave to crest or not. You could have a still water too. Very easily. And what I like to do when I'm doing a close-up like this is take my liner brush and actually create some little lines, which is what a liner brush is perfect for. And you get the paint nice and thin. So if your liner brush, I mean, it's literally almost water. And then you just start putting little lines in there. Branch them off. There's a few over here. Hey, there's one there. Little, you'll have in the surf, you'll have some dots of frothiness, you know. Like little lightning bolts in your up front here that we're seeing through the break here. You could have a rock in there too. Same thing over here. This is all just how you want it to go. It's up to you. And then I like to take, I may want to go up here in some of my stars. I'll often take a different color and put over them and accent them a little bit. Little blues, some purples. We'll deal with the clouds in a minute. Add some few dots. You can crest your very top of your waves. Add a little extra light. Look at it, stand back and look at it and go, yeah, there's something going on here I'm missing. I'm going to do that. You know? With the brush being held very loosely in the hand and going horizontal with it, you can create some interesting shapes. Pull up on it whenever you want. Give it a little work. And that's about it. Don't want to do too much, he says as he continues to paint. Just showing you what's possible. Water is one of the easier things. If you really, if you don't like it, paint over it. Start again. Movement is one of the hardest things to get when you're painting, so if you get an opportunity to do it, a little bit of yellow. Adding a little color inside of your waves will really pop them. I'm just holding the liner brush horizontal and pulling up, which adds a little bit of color, a little bit of life. And it's your water. You can do whatever you want to it. And I'm just moving around. You can go back into your white. You can really create something interesting here. Got some purple in there by mistake. Going back into my transparent white and yellow mixture. Wish I could show you guys my canvas, my palette, but you know, one camera. You can literally grab it, pull it yourself. Create some horizon effects if you want. Be careful with pure white, because this, wherever your sun is setting, is not going to be pure white. It's going to be yellow, orange, red. It's going to have a mixture of those colors that you can accent. If you get too much detail on your mountains, it'll appear too close. Be careful with that. But as your eye sees things, just jump around and add it. And what I was thinking is that right here, I've got something dramatic going on. I'm just going in the wet brush, and I'm pulling up on it. There's something really kind of crazy going on over here. Almost pure water now. Just grabbing the color and just dragging it up. Grab the pigment from below and just drag it up. That's pretty cool. A little bit of the yellow. Because you have your striations in the back, striations of the clouds in the back. So what you're doing and pull and blend it in. Okay, that's about it. You know, if you want to go up in your mountains here in your clouds a little bit with your liner brush, do a few accents, pulling the brush sideways, can't hurt. The rule of thumb is the last thing you do will basically be the first thing that catches the eye of your observer. All right, this one, I'm just going to put some orange right here, and end it a little bit, end it on a high note, a little bit of transparent yellow, and we'll do a blob of white right in the middle. I'm just going to blend that across straight, clean up our horizon line. And I'm going to put a bit, a streak of red in there. Don't be afraid. Perfect. Grab some white. That's too much. Take it off. Again, I'm breaking all the rules of painting here, but you get what I'm doing. I'm going to add that line. Bring that right up. There's something seriously going on that horizon. And to me, that's what makes a painting come alive, is when you add these accents. Water. Just going to grab it and pull it out beyond my horizon line. A little bit up on my mountains. Thing here. I'm literally just pushing, letting the paint fly off the brush in any fashion that it wants to. And as long as it keeps doing what you want, you're on the way. Wet the brush. Get a nice wash going. And what we're doing is that we're just going to bring, we want to preserve our colors, but I want to wash over that orange. And I'm going to put away that brush. I'll grab this wonderful little scrubby brush I told you about earlier and do some circles. Wet it a tiny bit. I'm just doing circles to blend that back. You can hear how hard I'm scrubbing that. Perfect. And that creates a nice effect. I'm using the same brush. I'm just hitting my clouds up here. It's going to give them a little bit of life, a little bit of orange, a little bit of orange and white, a little bit of iridescent white. And dry the brush off and start my circles. Just create some cloud shapes. that are being accented here. Just a little bit. Have some pure white. Okay. All you're trying to do is indicate a little bit of cloud shape up there. Done with that brush. Let's grab my blender. Careful, it's still wet. Lightly blend them in. This cloud shape. Some of you guys can do a lot better than me, because I don't like a straight line, and I've got one going on here, but this is for demonstration only. Alright, that's done. Just a little extra work, a few wispies. Just indicating something's going on in the sky. That's about it, friends. There's a lot more you could do with this type of stuff. But how much time do you really want to spend doing it? Literally be here for hours. Hope you got something out of this. Value differences in a white background and a black background, and how you can create different elements and different things within them. And I hope you learned something, and I'll be back more with either oil painting or something, or another drip painting. Thank you. Don't forget to find it. Later.